A little different picture of Kevin Ullman from last night, yes? You know, if we were doing this event 10 years ago, I wouldn't have to mention the following couple of things. First, if you have a cell phone, please put it on silent or vibrate. And, you know, today social media is a major, major force in getting the word out on all kinds of things, all kinds of events, all kinds of initiatives. So anybody who wants to, please feel free. We encourage you to post photos, post comments, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, wherever, whatever you like to do. We encourage you to do that. So as many of you know, I started out in the music world, and I kind of morphed, kind of evolved into, I'm kind of now in the money business. And one of the things I've learned in the money business is not much happens without money. So, you know, we're here today to talk about how music can help people change and grow and develop. We're going to talk about that from a variety of perspectives. But one of the things we do know is that not much is going to happen if there isn't money to support these efforts. So, and particularly today's event would not have happened without some very, very generous people. So before we start, I'd like to acknowledge the individuals who helped make this possible by funding it. So first, I'd like to acknowledge the NAMM Foundation. They are our title sponsor. Thank you very much. And then I'd like to acknowledge a group, I don't know if you know them, I think it's at Rundgren Radio? You know, last night I talked to Doug and I said, you know, we really should do this thing in New York soon. So I'm trying to convince him that'll be the next Little Rocktopia will be Little New Yorktopia, all right? And then I want to, believe it or not, I have some very close friends at some big financial firms, big surprise. I was sitting at a dinner with the president of Fidelity, and we're talking, and it turns out he's a guitar player, he's a Todd fan, I said. And then it turns out another group I work with, National Financial, I'm sitting with the president of the company, and one of his first jobs, or first businesses, he actually made t-shirts and sold them at Todd concerts. So, you know, the first thing I did is I called him up. I said, guys, you have a great chance to help support, you know, one of Todd's great initiatives. So they were very generous, and they decided to sponsor this event. So let's thank them for that. Okay. And then we have some other individuals who are very generous, Mark and Mira Bagley. And if I mispronounce any names, please forgive me. Monica Gornick-Eakin, is that correct? Eakin? Okay. Joe Griesler, Dr. Eric and Cynthia Johnson, thank you. I was just chatting with Peter Morelli. Are you still on that side, Peter? Okay. I think many of you know Bill Mullen. Holly Mae Smith, thank you, thank you. And Bruce Whetstone. Okay. So I also want to thank the Clinton School of Public Service for providing this wonderful you know, opportunity for us and being supportive and help making it happen. I also want to thank Phil, I hope this is correct, Mariage. Of National Public Radio. Kathleen Forsyth, are you here? All right. Dave Kinder, thank you very much. And apparently, I didn't realize it, that the Bruno family actually owns Little Rock. I didn't know that, but. We had a great dinner there last night. Thank you very much. And then very special for me, I want to thank all the musicians last night. John Siegler, Jesse Gress, Ralph Schuckett, Michelle Rundgren, Kimberly Anderson, and who's the other guy? Oh, J-Po, that's who it was. Yeah. And then, of course, I want to thank all of you for making the trip, making the effort, spending the time to really support this organization and support this effort. I think after today, you're going to be even more convinced that this is a wonderful organization to support, and I think you're going to feel very, very good about it. So thank you again. So this is a music program, so it's appropriate that we start off with some music. We're going to bring up the Arkansas Symphony Youth Orchestra Brass Quintet. So come on up, fellas and lady. I had a brief senior moment. I went up to the director and I said, by the way, I just want to make sure, how many people are in the quintet? You all set? Oh, it's five. Okay, I just wanted to check. That was a joke. He thought I was serious. Maybe his parents are senile. Gentlemen, lady, hit it. Thank you. Test. Can you hear me? No? Testing.
He's over there now.
Hello? So when Ed first asked me if I'd like to get involved with the Spirit of Harmony Foundation, he said it was, supporting early childhood music education. And I said, well, heck yes, I definitely believe in that. And the reason is I have a very, very personal story that I'm going to share with you. I haven't actually told too many people this story, but I think will illustrate why I feel so strongly about this organization. And I'm going to say to you today that if it wasn't for music, I don't think I would be alive. I think I would be dead. I really do. When I was a teenager, I was a troubled teenager. I had trouble at school, I had trouble at home, I had trouble with the law, I had all kinds of trouble. And at one point, before that, I was very involved with music. I was practicing drums all the time, I was in bands, I was taking lessons, I was working hard on my music, but everything else in my life was a mess, a complete mess. And my parents decided at one point that, you know, had gone far enough and they were gonna intervene and do something. And they ended up putting me in a youth home. So that's, you know, it sounds nice. It was a nice facility, but it was definitely, you know, it had a lock on it. And they basically said, look, you know, until you get your act together, this is your new home. So you better start trying to straighten yourself up. So this is the kind of place that had all kinds of therapy activities. They had recreational therapy and occupational therapy and sports therapy and water therapy and group therapy and individual therapy. Everything had therapy. So one day, the first week, I'm meeting with the doctor, a shrink, and one-on-one. He says, you know, I spoke to your parents. I have a pretty good idea of their perspective, but I'd like to talk to you and understand from you how you see your life. So I tell him about my school, and I tell him my perspective up at home, and I tell him all about the drums and my teacher and all the things that I'm doing. And he says to me at the end, he says, well, you know, I have good news and I have bad news for you. I said, what's the bad news? He says, well, I think if you don't straighten your act out right now, you're going to be dead or in jail within a year. I said, really? What's the good news? He says, well, it seems like everything in your life is a mess. Your home life is a mess, your school life is a mess, your community life is a mess. But the one thing that's going well seems to be the music and your drumming. So you're apparently, you know, you're very diligent, you're practicing every day. At that time, it was like practicing 8 hours a day, every day. You have a teacher. You do what your teacher tells you. You won't do what your teachers at school tell you, but you do what your drum teacher tells you. So I practice everything that he says. You take care of your instrument, even though you don't take care of your room, according to your parents. You take care of your instrument. You work. You're in a band. You get along with your band. You're able to function. You're doing gigs. You're making money. You're going out and doing things. Everything about your life is a mess except the music. So this is the best part. He takes out his prescription pad, and he says, I'm going to prescribe music for you. I'm not kidding. Literally writes on the pad, and he gives it to the nurses. Okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to give him a room, and kind of ironically, they gave me the barbershop. At that time, I had hair to my waist. I hadn't seen a barbershop in years, but now they gave me the barbershop after hours to use as my drum room. He calls my father, says, look, I want you to pack up his drums, get a friend, get a teacher, get somebody, pack up the drums, I want them here immediately. And every single day, for 2 hours, you have that room to practice, do whatever you want, you can practice drums. So two things happen. One is, now all of a sudden this guy is somebody I can trust. He gets it, he understands who I am and where I'm coming from. And, you know, I'm willing to follow him. So he says, now look, what we're going to do is we're going to say, this is your success model. So music and drumming is your success model. You know, so now in order to be a good musician, you have to get a teacher. You have to do what the teacher tells you. You have to practice diligently. You have to get an instrument. You have to take care of it. You know, you have to tune it. You have to maintain it. You can't just treat it, you know, poorly. And then typically you're going to work in a group, either like a brass quintet or I was in a rock band. And you have to figure out how to work with other people, and you have to blend together as a group. So the tremendous, tremendous skills that you learn from being a musician. So he says, we're going to rebuild your life based on music. That's going to be your success model. And, you know, I started working with him, and I trusted him, and he said, well, now I want you to go to also occupational therapy. Okay, fine. I want you to go to sports therapy. Fine. So I did whatever he told me to do, and it did take a while. I was there for a year, if you can imagine. But I did, he said, in order to get out, you have to have three things. You have to have, because you can't go home, because you're home, forget it, that's a mess. So you have to have an acceptance to college. I was accepted at Berklee School of Music. You have to have an apartment. You can't go home to your family's apartment. So I got an apartment. And you have to have a job so you can support yourself, because you can't take any more money from your family. So I did all of those three things, and I'm now out. So for the rest of my life, everything that I have done other than music, I pattern after that. So when I got into this business, I got a teacher. I had a mentor. I, you know, listened and I studied and how do you do these things? And I went to school and I did my lessons and I practiced and all the things you're supposed to do. And if you follow that music model, you can apply it to practically anything in life and succeed. So from, you know, everybody here you're going to speak today has a slightly different take and a slightly different perspective. My take is that music is a tremendous success model, and if you teach children how to play music and how to play in groups, because that's the key, in my opinion, you got to play in a group, they are going to learn life skills which will change their lives and allow them to be successful throughout their life. So I'd like to bring up someone who's very special to me. You know, in the course of your life, you meet people who give you an opportunity or a platform to find yourself and express yourself. And when I was playing music, I started out playing with Manhattan Transfer and Bette Midler and Barry Manilow. And while all those people were, you know, substantial musicians, there wasn't really a lot opportunity for a lot of drumming in those situations. And no matter what I did, I know, remember with Bette, no matter what I did, it was too fast, it was too slow, it was too loud, it's not funky enough, it's too funky. You know, whatever it was, it wasn't right. But finally, I got an opportunity to play with Todd. And Todd gave me a platform to really find my voice, to find my voice. And, you know, I don't think he ever once said, you know, play it this way, play it that way. He would just, we'd play the song, and it would just kind of evolve. And as long as nobody hit me on the head, I figured I was doing things okay. And then if it was good enough to be recorded, then I guess it sounds pretty good. So I want to say thank you, Todd. I appreciate the fact that you gave me that opportunity. You know, and then again, in, I think it was 2001, we had a reunion on CNBC, and then again a few years ago we had a reunion, got a chance to tour again, and then today. So there's been lots of opportunities for me to be able to be that guy again, you know, because this is who I am now. It's not so terrible, but, you know, it's not the same guy I was last night. So I really enjoy being able to do that. So thank you again. So I'd like to bring up Todd Rundgren for a few comments.
Now I have the mic. How about our little Kevin all grown up? Give it up for him. I feel like I'm at an Apple announcement of some kind. Maybe a pill you swallow that lives in you and interfaces with your iPhone 12. Most of you, or many of you, in this room probably had something to do with why we're here today. And I thought it'd be worth reminding everyone exactly how we got here. We had a fan event in Louisiana less than 2 years ago. It'd been 2 years ago in June. And we were having our usual good debaucherous time at our little event out at a plantation, arguing about slavery and stuff, and somebody, you know, our fans, you know, they have this group mind thing, this hive mind in some ways. You know what I'm talking about. I'm talking to you. And thought, maybe we should do something for the city of New Orleans, and because our core interest happens to be music, maybe it should have something to do with music. So the forces that be within you found a program in the lower Ninth Ward that was kind of suffering after the hurricane, trying to recover kind of the stronghold they had had before that, and needed a little, just a little attention, maybe. You know, they were like everything else in New Orleans, struggling to get back on their feet. And so the fans decided that they would take a collection amongst themselves. And we got a big fake check. There, we left them at the amount blank for dramatic emphasis. And went down and listened to this group of kids of all ages, you know, very young kids. They had a couple of classes, a couple of stages there, but very young kids, but all strings, playing nothing but string instruments, violins and double basses and the whole deal. And it was a little hard to listen to sometimes. But I think what grabbed all of us, you know, was how hard they were trying to, you know, to keep this program going, how hard each of the individual kids were trying to master their instrument, how much love there was between the musicians and their mentors. And everyone wanted to sort of re-experience that in some way, even if it was vicariously, even if you couldn't be there at the actual event. So, again, those mysterious forces that be within you somehow organized to have Ed and Gene formally propose to me that we establish a foundation that, in essence, would encourage these fledgling programs. We didn't really know what the mission would be. It's just it was an emotional thing, as is music. I know in the program it says I'm supposed to talk about the emotional impact of music, like beating a freaking dead horse. You know, why do people like music? Because it touches them, obviously. You know, so and in some primal way. So it's not up to me to kind of unravel that entire thing. But we all had a very emotional reaction to the experience, just the fact that they were trying so hard to create music, that music meant enough for them to struggle, to continue to struggle through all of this hardship and lack in order to be able to play together, to create some music, which ultimately, and then in the end, you know, in an egg-headed event like this, I hopefully don't have to remind everyone that music is kind of a service we give each other. It's something that our lives would be very bleak without. And so even if it's crappy music, at least it's music. So I'm not talking about the program in New Orleans, all right? No, that was beautiful to us. And so the fans collected $10,000, wrote it out on this big fake check. They did it just over the course of a couple of days because it wasn't like a big plan that we had. And as I said, the reward that everyone got for their contribution was so great that they said, we need to do this more, we need to do it again. And that's when Ed and Gene approached me and said, would you figurehead essentially the, you know, the burning desire and all of our fans and anyone that we can kind of get to our cause, you know, to help these programs. And fortunately, I guess, for us, you know, once we started the process of going nonprofit, it happened so fast that we didn't have a lot of time to refine our mission. We just, you know, we're generally in the category of, you know, where a nonprofit should be in terms of, you know, what effect we wanted to eventually have. But this essentially is part of that. Being able to get people together, even though all of you are probably true believers already, we need to get down in documentary form what it is that we're trying to do. And what it is, I believe, that we're trying to do, and as hopefully we will reemphasize here while we have the panel up, that it's great to like music and it's great to be a music consumer, but it may be actually critical to be able to understand music at a very young age, because it will have an effect on your brain, it'll have an effect on your lifestyle, it may have an effect on your ultimate ability to earn in the long run. And the fact that so many, you know, it's poignant because I, you know, talked to somebody today. I had a little signing in the afternoon, and one woman came up to me and said, you know, we don't even have our local school boards anymore to make the decisions about what's going to be on the curriculum. So obviously, in some places, you're going to lose ground in your ability to establish something as important as early music education, which I was fortunate enough to have when I grew up. They had instrument rental programs and traveling tutors, and they would at least get you interested in music. They would, as a matter of kind of like normal elementary school upbringing, teach you songs about other cultures that you would sing. I still know about a little boy in Trinidad who was sometimes good and sometimes bad. And I won't get into the rest of it because it's still in there. So hopefully, you know, I've elucidated a little bit, you know, what it is we're trying to do. We're ultimately trying to get kids musicalized at the earliest possible point in their lives, which probably comes naturally to most of us. And the only thing that is missing is the ability to express that, the ability to consider that part of your daily bread. And so I think it's time to start the panel. Can you, Kevin? I'm still not used to the short hair. I still remember it down to here.
Thank you, Todd. I'd like to invite all the panelists up, starting with Margaret. And Margaret Martin, can you come on up? Nina Kraus. George Ford. Carl Mouton. And Mary Lurson.
Have a seat. That's you. That's you.
So last night we had a dinner at, guess where? Bruno's, with all of the panelists so we could talk to each other and understand a little bit about what's going to happen. And I have to say I have a new hero. So Margaret is my new hero. Margaret is someone who is, what I say, walking the talk. She's really actually making a difference, and I hope when my days are over I can make as much of a difference in the world as she has already. So I'd like to bring up Dr. Margaret Martin. Thank you. You can sit or stand, whatever you're comfortable doing.
Is this on?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm supposed to talk about the social impact of music education. And I guess I should start with a Sunday morning in Los Angeles. Posse of LA gang members walked through a farmer's market, shaved heads, teardrop tattoos, oversized clothing. They stopped in front of a tiny kid playing Brahms on a tiny violin. After 5 or 6 minutes without saying a word to one another, I watched those gang members pull out their own money and lay it gently in the child's case. I was at UCLA at the time, completing a doctorate in public health, focused on what it takes to make a healthy community. Those gang members were teaching me that they would rather be doing what that child was doing than what they were doing, but they never had the chance. When I finished that, I dug into the research literature, and music was linked to improvements in math, language, cognition, brain development, behavior. And for me that day, it was essentially an authentic moment of grace. It was like the heavens opened and God spoke, and I had to try. If it hadn't worked, I'd be doing something else. But oh boy, has it ever worked. So what we do is we go into the highest crime gang zones in Los Angeles and give you a little frame of reference. Little Rock has, what's the population of Little Rock? What? About 200,000? In 2007, the LA Almanac reported that Los Angeles County had 1,300 different violent gangs and 150,000 gang members. That'd be like 3 out of every 4 people in Little Rock being members of a gang. And that was in 2007. And before I came out here, I checked the Los Angeles Police Department website. And that website reported that gang membership has grown steadily in the last 5 years. So that's, kids are recruited in gangs early in elementary school. And you really have to have a gang affiliation or you can be hurt or even killed. It's actually a pretty difficult situation. Nationally, we've got close to a 50% dropout rate in our 50 largest cities, largely among kids who grew up in poor families of color. That's indefensible. It's a horrible return on our investment. The social costs are enormous. So what we've done is we've gone into the highest crime neighborhoods and we've connected high-need kids with professional musician mentors, 5 to 10 hours per week, year-round, tuition-free, including their instruments, for their entire childhood. And we build bands and orchestras in those neighborhoods. Today, we've got 2,000 kids playing in ensembles throughout LA. Our waiting list has over 500 kids waiting because we don't have the money to pay the teachers. We've got 120 some odd professional musicians that work for us, and we have affiliated programs in seven states, including the program that Todd just described in New Orleans. So it's just taken off like crazy. I'm proud to say that this year we had 52 high school graduates. 100% of them have been accepted to 2 or 4 year colleges. You have to understand that these are neighborhoods with 50% dropout rates, but of the kids who graduate from high school, fewer than 10% graduate with basic English language proficiency. And with our class of 2014, 40% of those graduates in the class of 2014 went into engineering and biomedical science. We have 3 neuroscience majors right now. We've got a genetics major, civil engineering major, medical engineering. We've had 2 Fulbright awards. And we've only been around 14 years. So for a little kid, a lot of our students come in and they're really shy. They don't talk. If you can't talk, if you can't express yourself, you can't ask questions. You can't ask for help. You can't report abuse. You can't negotiate in a relationship or in a job. It's a pretty big deal. It impacts, I'm sure there are plenty of people in this room who've had situations that would have gone a lot better if you'd only spoken up, if you'd only been able to express yourself. Well, little shy kids come in, and you put an instrument into her hands, and then you commit to her 5 to 10 hours a week of lessons and ensemble practice, and you learn to work with other people. So what is that? 5 to 10 hours a week of kids practicing listening carefully to one another and agreeing. If you don't agree, it doesn't sound good. And I promise you, this is a tonic for our inner cities. But if members of Congress had grown up within Harmony Project, we would have a far more functional because it's about doing the hard work of coming together, of listening closely to one another, of valuing all the different voices. You know, our kids tell us, you can't just have cellos. You can't just have flutes. You need all the voices. And together, it sounds good, but it only sounds good if you really work hard. I mean, think about it. Americans, we've become a nation of spectators. Americans spend their time and treasure watching other people do stuff. When I was a kid, we called ourselves citizens. We traded that word in for another word like 30 years ago. It also starts with a C. What is it?
Consumer.
The most patriotic thing a consumer can do is to go freaking shopping. After 9/11, that's all the advice our president had to give us. Go shopping. Well, in his social class, retail therapy can work, but everybody doesn't have the wherewithal to go shopping. Consumers can't build healthy communities. Citizens do that. So kids who come together and they learn to do the hard fun of practicing incrementally building their skills over time with other people to achieve something really beautiful, those are generalizable skills. And we can count on our students to create futures of which we can all be proud. They get this gnarly looking piece of music, they're not daunted, because they learn how to take it apart and to work on it in pieces and then put it together with other people. I mean, whether it's in a family relationship, whether it's in a work relationship, whether it's looking at a problem in a community, these are the skills we need. And we need kids, we need individuals who have voices. And then what we do is, as our kids advance, we train them to mentor their less advanced peers. So while they find their voice, they come full circle and end up helping their peers find theirs. Another part of it is that kids who are disconnected people have higher rates of mental health problems. Our kids talk about if they have a bad day, they take out their instrument, they play, and after a while they're okay emotionally. We're living in a country that's spending $7 billion on drugs to help kids focus and learn. And more than that, on psychoactive medications that are teaching our kids that they need some pharmacology in order to survive. Our kids need their instruments, and they can do it themselves. And they can teach their peers to do it too. So we're talking about personal responsibility, we're talking about resilience, we're talking about emotionally healthy people, and we're talking about the kind of people we need in every community in this country, getting to work with one another, figuring out how to agree, and how to listen carefully to one another. And those are the things, think about it, is there anything else in our school system that teaches all of those things so elegantly to hundreds of kids at the same time? I don't think so. It's unique. That's what I have to say.
Thank you. So Todd said, and I think it's very true, that all of us intuitively know that music is good. I don't think you'd walk up to anybody on the street and say, you know, do you think music is good? And everybody says, oh yeah, music, of course it's good. But why is it good? And what does it actually do? So Dr. Nina Kraus is actually starting to figure out exactly what music does to us on a really scientific level, and it's not just anecdotal, but she's got some hard science to back up some of these ideas. So, Dr. Nina Kraus.
Thank you, Kevin. So I get to talk to you about the biological benefits of music education and the impact on communication. So some of the most powerful forces in our lives are invisible, and sound is no exception. Sound is this amazing, invisible force that is central to human communication. And I want to talk about signals, because I know you like signals. When Todd visited my lab, it was just really easy to talk, because as Todd knows, sound moves in time, and there is so much information in time all at once. Time moves in seconds, in microseconds, in minutes, and it's the same whether it's music or it's speech, and it requires of the brain probably the most incredible gymnastics in terms of its computational ability. And think, so, you know, sound moves in time. So does language, the way when we talk. If you know, you need to have a brain that moves efficiently in time in order for us to understand each other as we speak. So how does the brain do this? So as I'm talking to you now, the nerves in your brain that respond to sound are giving off electricity. And with scalp electrodes, we can measure that electricity. Electricity is the currency of the nervous system. And we can get, you know, some response like this, and then we can filter it and look at the slow, the fast, and the in-between, all the details that, that the brain is transmitting and transcribing as we're listening to sounds. And, you know, think, you know, an example of something slow is the rhythm of footsteps. The crunch of leaves is in between. The snap of a branch is something that happens very fast. And I want to spend my time telling you about the really the fast stuff, because it's only been recently, and I'm really, I'm hearing a lot of right? I don't know what we can do about, is there anything we can, are we okay? Okay, all right. So it's only recently that we've been able to get the kind of detail from human beings about how it is that they're processing sound, so that we can begin to look at the impact of the sound of the sounds of our lives on our brains. So here's what we do. We play sounds and we measure responses. So, but look, you can see that this brain wave actually physically resembles the sound wave. I mean, that's crazy that you could be able to actually see how the brain processes sound. It turns out you can take those signals, feed them back through an amplifier, and you can listen to how the brain hears. So here's a sound wave. And here's the brain wave. Some more examples. There's a scale and the brain's response to the scale. Don't have time for Mozart, but little Deep Purple, and we have a whole library of these on our website if you want to have fun with that. But importantly, the way that our brain transcribes sound is experience dependent. It depends on the languages we speak, the music we make, and the things that we spend a lot of time doing, practicing, really working on, have an enormous impact on how our brain automatically responds to sound, which is going to be important when you're processing all kinds of sounds, not just music. So it turns out that music making enhances sound processing in the brain. And when I'm talking about musicians, I'm not talking about professional musicians. These are hobbyists. These are people who regularly engage in making music. And so, you know, we can see it just in the brain's responses. What we can see is that the brain's response to sound is much more precise. It is much more stable and consistent. So if you play a sound and then you play the same sound again, the brain will respond consistently. If you have a jittered response to sound, how are you to learn? We need a brain that can distinguish one sound from another. Speech sounds happen actually very, very quickly in time. And the brain, again, has to make these time computations. So these skills, these for the brain to process sound, this is fundamental for language, and this is enhanced with music. And kids who have, for example, reading problems. These, you know, reading really depends on sound to meaning associations, and these kids have difficulty transcribing sound. We can simulate what it's like for a musician to hear a clip.
This is a talk to an audience on sound. Very special. This is, if you can see, the numbers will go 2-11.
All right, so Nigel heard through a dyslexic brain.
This is a small tool, you know, we use on the central. There's a central purpose. If you can see, the numbers will go to 11.
Okay, so you're interfacing with the world in a very different way. A very pragmatic, a very practical skill that we have to do, whether it's in a noisy classroom or an airport or in a truck, we have to be able to hear each other in noisy environments. And is when we play music, we have to listen to details, meaningful, relevant sounds from a complex soundscape. Here are the three bops, and they're each listening to the sound of their own instrument. And we asked, would this skill transfer to hearing your friend's voice in a noisy restaurant or a teacher's voice in a noisy classroom where there's traffic outside, teachers scraping? And the answer is resoundingly yes, that people with regular musical training and experience just simply can make sense of sound in a noisy environment. So tell me if you can hear a sentence in here. Anybody hear a sentence? Whoa, 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 whoa. I'll talk to you later. Now, listen. You got it, right? Okay, so you can see it beautifully and objectively in the brain's response. This is why these responses are so meaningful and important, in that, you know, when you test a child or anyone, you know, how much sleep have they gotten the night before? How do they feel? Do they want to cooperate? There's so many, do they understand the task? The brain doesn't lie. You can just see very, very clearly that a response to speech in the musician and the non-musician in quiet is actually pretty similar. But you put it in noise, and you can see that the musician's response is as though unaffected by the noise. It's still robust and clear. And the non-musician, this is a person, this is a kid who's going to have a hard time hearing his teacher in the classroom. Music training also involves memory, so the memorization of sound and visual patterns, auditory motor sequences. To tune your instrument, you've got to remember the note to tune your instrument. If you have a musical idea and I'm going to improvise on it, I got to remember what your idea was. So all of this exercises auditory working memory. If you're making any sense of what I'm saying to you right now, it's because you can remember what I just said to you a few seconds ago to make sense of what I'm saying to you right now. Auditory working memory is absolutely crucial for language, for communication, for interaction. And again, if you just take standardized tests of auditory working memory, musicians outperform non-musicians across the lifespan. Gonna play something embarrassing, but it's gonna illustrate, you know, if you're a hack musician like me and you wanna learn a lick, you listen to it and then you try to play it and then you forget it. You have to listen to it again and you try to resolve the physical complexity of playing it. But you're exercising your auditory working memory. So it's very obvious when Chuck is playing and when he is not. Rhythm, banging on the drum. Turns out, rhythm is very obvious in music. Turns out to be very, very important for language as well. And because it marks where meaning stops and starts, where emphasis is, it enables us to predict and anticipate what people are saying, important for conversational turn-taking. Turns out that the very simple ability to tap along to a beat, to follow a beat, tracks with language skills. People have shown this now. There's converging evidence showing this again and again. So here's a kid, here's a three-year-old, who's pretty good at synchronizing to a beat. And this little guy hasn't quite gotten there. Enthusiastic, though. And it turns out that this ability to predict, you know, you're coordinating your auditory and your motor system This tracks with brain function. You can just see it in the brain's response. So, you know, the top line is the signal, is the sound that has an envelope that moves and changes in time. It has a rhythm. And the red line is somebody, when it is a kid, who can synchronize to the beat. And his brain just automatically follows those rhythms in the sound. And the poor synchronizer, his brain just misses it. It just misses it. So a lot of the work that we do is done in a laboratory, and the work is funded in traditional ways by the government, the National Science Foundation, NIH. But we wanted to take our work outside of the laboratory and into schools, and it was Margaret and her counterparts in the Chicagoland area who came to me and said, you know, our kids who are playing music, they're just doing better in school. They are better learners. What's going on in their brains? And so we aim to find out. We have a project in Chicago area schools and a project with Margaret's Harmony Project out in LA. And what's important to know is that these both are in low-income areas. And kids who grow up in poverty, linguistic deprivation is something that is characteristic often of kids who grow up in poverty, especially it is linked with maternal education. So kids whose moms have less education, typically the kids hear, you know, 30 million fewer words by the time they're five than the kids whose moms have more education. And what we were able to do is to look at our Chicago high school kids, and we divided them simply based on their mom's education. These are kids educated in the same classroom. And what we found was that the kids whose moms had less education, these are kids who had just more neural noise. In the absence of sound, there was just noise in their brains. Whereas the kids who are likely to have had more linguistic enrichment, these are kids who had stronger responses to sound. And again, the kids whose moms had less education had a signal that was just, it's as though, the analogy that works for me is as though you're listening to the radio, there's static in the background, and then the announcer's voice is not coming through very clearly, so the announcer's voice is muffled. And again, we can simulate this. So this would be just a typically developing kid listening to this phrase.
Now, what you got right now, the door to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not as rich as you.
Okay, a kid in poverty, though, with linguistic deprivation, might hear it like this. Very hard to make sense of sound. So what we did in the Harmony Project is, you know, we looked at brain's responses, and we wanted to see how does this track with language development. So reading, kids from low-income areas, their reading scores, we know that the achievement gap drops. And so from second to third grade, the kids who did not have music, their reading scores got worse. But the kids who had music in the Harmony Project, they stayed steady with their national average. For hearing, speech, and noise, this took 2 years. After 2 years, we saw that the kids who had the music classes, their ability to hear, speech, and noise was simply better. And when we measured brain responses to sound, both the fast and the slow elements of sound, automatically the kids who were engaged in, this was in the Chicago cohort, who were engaged in music classes, their brains were just able to pick out the important elements of sound automatically and better than kids who had another form of activity. And these, again, were kids educated in the same classrooms otherwise. And the kids in band, their reading scores were simply better. Again, the Harmony Project kids, their brains, after 2 years, were simply better at distinguishing speech sounds, at distinguishing consonants. That red that you see indicates better timing. And so their brains just had better timing, and just automatically, in terms of being able to distinguish one sound from another. And we didn't see a change in the randomly assigned control group. A very important part of the message is that this is not a quick fix. After 1 year, neither in the Chicago adolescents nor in the LA elementary school, we saw no changes in the brain. We saw no changes in these skills and wiring of the nervous system that is so fundamental for language. It took 2 years. And also, the kids who were most engaged, it takes active engagement. So the kids, you know, you're not going to get it from music appreciation. It was the kids who practiced a lot and showed up. Those are the kids whose brains showed the most impact of the music education. So summing up then, making music strengthens the brain for language. We can see this objectively, and it takes time. It's not a quick fix. And I like to say that biologically, we are what we do, which really gives us a lot of responsibility for the choices that we make for ourselves, for our children, for our kids educationally. And biologically also, our past shapes our present. What next? So we have this powerful biological snapshot of auditory processing in humans, and we're working to empower scientists, educators, policymakers, and you. We're working with partners to make a platform that is inexpensive and user-friendly so that we can gather, I mean, you know, the information that we have now, we're just scratching the surface. Knowledge really gives us strength to address the issues that we want to address educationally. The idea of keeping the arts, putting the arts, giving the arts an enormous place in the school system and in our kids' education. So I need to acknowledge all of the people in my lab who do all of the heavy lifting. And I want to invite you, please, to visit our website. And the website is a labor of love, and it's really important to us to communicate our little discoveries out of the lab for anyone who is interested in what it is that we're finding. We have, for each one of our projects, we have these overview slideshows that are just a picture and a line of text that summarize 2 years of work. But I hope that you will find it useful in having evidence for the ideas that you may want to put forward educationally. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. So at the end of the day, it's very important to keep in mind, what is it that we're trying to accomplish? Ultimately, we want to make sure that music education is prevalent throughout the school systems in America, and that everybody supports the idea of music education the same way they support math, science, reading, sports, all the other educational programs. And our vision is this is going to happen in two different ways. One is grassroots efforts, which means really kind of empowering, educating parents and others who are influential in the community to encourage and ask for programs. But last night I was at dinner at where?
Bruno's.
And I was sitting with George, and he talked about the second component, which is public policy and changing public policy. And he pointed out that, well, if you go to the school board, you go to the principal and the parents who now are, you know, they're charged up, I want music education, you say to them, well, we want to spend, you know, $10,000, we want a music program, we want it now. And the first question he's going to ask is, well, of course, how much is it going to cost? And what is the financial benefit going to be? Can we measure it? So George pointed this out to me yesterday, and he's going to talk about how to understand some of these, the cost-benefit relationship in music education, and what some of the the future efforts we need to make. George?
Thank you. Normally, as an economist, I don't get to follow somebody whose work is more complicated than my own, so this is a blessing tonight. We asked the question earlier, what is the effect, the real effect of music on the brain? And then the next question is what is the value of that effect? And really what we're talking about in that case is what is the net value of that effect? And I know that bothers some people, perhaps. I don't know if this is working or not. Maybe I can live without it. See if you can get that working. And I'll keep going. The net value, and that's if we can generate $100 million for doing something in benefits, that sounds nice. That's a big number. We like big numbers in public policy. But what if it costs $200 million to produce that $100 million in benefit? Now, if someone said, well, I'll tell you what, I'll sell you that $100 million for $180, give you a 10% discount, my wife might be into that. She might think that was a good deal. But we really wouldn't want to do that as a public policy practice. So we have to begin to think, what is the value of music, education? And I think as you look at the literature, you see a lot of discussion about effects, but very little discussion about value. In fact, you see very little discussion about cost. Some, I was speaking earlier with Mary from NAM, and she says she's focused on that now, and they've done some work in the past, but you don't see a lot of that, and you don't see a lot of work on the value of benefits, and there are a number of reasons for that. I'm going to try to walk you through how, as an economist, I have begun to wrap my head around this issue, which is not, I have not completely wrapped around my head around this issue, and probably don't think I'll be able to in my lifetime and maybe another generation or two because of the nature of music. It's not something that lends itself very well to monetization of its value. It's a very deep phenomena. It's spiritual. Aesthetic, all those things that are difficult for economists to deal with, unfortunately. Let me jump ahead here. When we ask what's the value of education or what's the purpose of music education, we can start by just asking the basic question of what is the value of education? Music is a component of education. It's in the set of things that we do. And there are sort of two ways we generally think about it as economists and other people who dabble in this space. One is the private benefits of education. You say, well, maybe music will get you a better job, get higher pay. Maybe you'll make a living being a musician. These are private benefits. These are benefits that are obtained by the individual who is trained or educated in music. They're personal and private. And we treat those generally different in economics. And then there are social benefits, which is a lot of what we talk about in the literature and what we'll talk about tonight, and that is social cohesion, it's reduced crime rates, various other social benefits that aren't really private. Okay, we educate people generally so they're decent human beings and can participate in a civilized society more than just, well, maybe they'll make more money when they get out. So there are these social effects that are very important, and there are private effects that are very important. It's very important to keep those two things separate because they have different policy and economic implications. When you're looking at the arts, you add an element, and this is arts generally, and I think you might even could talk about science and math in some senses as having culture, a cultural valuation. There's the economic evaluations, the dollars and cents of it. Economic value is measurable. That's what economists do. Even when it's weird sometimes, we can come up with clever ways to value, put a dollar value on it. But then there's this cultural aspect of the arts where economists have kind of thrown their hands up at some point and says, okay, we know that these economic benefits are not it. There's this cultural component, but this cultural component is exceedingly difficult to quantify and always will be. until we come up with better economics, and maybe we will someday. We'll get more musicians in economics. Maybe we'll do a better job. I think the most important thing for understanding what you will hear tonight, what you will hear when you talk about this topic, is the difference between intrinsic value, which is the value of music for music's sake, and then the instrumental, we might call it the extrinsic, but the instrumental value of music, which is music for math's sake, which is music for poverty's sake, music for children's sake. It's not that the music, the value of the music is what you're after. It's the impact of music on something else, some policy trigger, mathematics scores. And I'm going to tell you why that's so important, and probably one reason, although this is an ancient idea. I had a quote in an earlier version of this from Plato, I think, where he was saying that music is important because it forms the basis of all of the other sciences. The rhythms and the mathematics and the patterns in it. But these are the two keys, and you have to think, because what you'll hear when we talk about the topic and when people talk about the topic is this jump around from the intrinsic value, which is music for music's sake, versus the instrumental value, and that is how does music impact test scores in mathematics or English or cognitive powers of various sorts, spatial reasoning or whatever it may be. And then we turn to the evidence, and there's a ton of evidence on this. Nina's stuff is the latest and greatest and most interesting and some of the most scientific of that, but there's a lot of evidence. People have been studying this for a very long time, and there are many inspiring anecdotes. If you want to hear them, you can just talk to Margaret for a while, and she'll fill your ears with them. And they're great stories, and there are many other people that can tell great stories. We heard a great story earlier today about how music changed somebody's life. But there are some problems with the literature, and I want to point out what those problems are so that when you see it, you can evaluate it for what it is. Number one is selection bias. And this is probably the number one criticism of the bulk of the literature. In fact, there have been a couple of papers published that basically shot down or attempted to shoot down everything that's ever been written on this topic a few years ago. I mean, it's not, the more recent literature is much better. But, you know, you go into a college, you measure the men's basketball team, and they say average out at 6'3". You go get the men on the college campus, and they average out at 5'8". And then you conclude that basketball makes you taller. This is an extreme example. It's more subtle than that usually. But the question is, among scientists that look at this data, is it that music makes you smarter, or do smarter people do music? And if you don't design the study properly, it's impossible to tell the difference. Now, this doesn't mean that that's true. Okay, although I think it probably is true. Mainly, and I think the research we listened to just now, people that come probably from backgrounds with smarter parents probably hear music better, maybe even. Yeah. I'm not talking about the studies. I'm just talking about why smarter people may do music, because they come prepared to hear the music initially better. It sounds better to them or clearer to them. So they have an advantage to some extent in hearing and participating in music. So what you need is experiments, and there have been many, many experimental studies or quasi-experimental studies, and that's the focus. If there's one good thing about the criticisms of the literature, is now the intense focus on designing good experiments with good control groups, random control groups. The other issue with the literature, and I don't view this as being a problem with the literature, is the nature of the treatments. Okay, and by treatment, I mean the pill. What's the pill? The treatments vary substantially across the literature. In one case, you had kids doing 4 hours of training a day, 6 days a week. The study concludes that the children in the program go to jail less. Yeah. Yeah. Is that music? Or is that time? Now, it's not What I'm not talking about that here. Let's say it's valuable, but some studies say, well, let's have kids play keyboard 30 minutes a day for a couple of days a week, and then one study will go back and look at people who were in the band, and now they look at their incomes or whatever it would be. But the treatments are all over the place, which makes it tricky to assess value because what you're doing is always different. And if you say, oh, well, music will do this, and then you say, well, we can't do 4 hours a day, 6 days a week in the public school system. We can do something else, 45 minutes a day, 3 days a week, or something like that. And so you have to try to match the treatment and then the outcome to what it is that you really want to do. I mean, the first question, and Todd talked about this earlier, and we spoke about it at dinner last night. The first question you have to ask is, what do you want to do? What is it that you want? And then you find out what the effect will be, and then you can quantify its value. You can't always do it every time. Okay, and sometimes you have to live with what you can do, but that's sort of the goal. We've got taking kids in gang neighborhoods in LA and teaching them music. It's a powerful treatment with powerful effects, right? You got a high school orchestra instructor, teacher. That's a totally different treatment. Are we talking about this program? Are we talking about that program? You have to decide what it is that you want to do before you start talking about the benefits, certainly of anything particular. And the other interesting thing that crossed my mind as I was studying this is there's no sugar pill in time. This is not something where I can say, I gave this guy 20 milligrams of statin, and I gave this guy the pill that looked exactly the same, but it was really just sugar or whatever the heck they make them out of. You can't do that with music. If you stick somebody in a room for 45 minutes and have them play a keyboard or whatever they might do, play in an orchestra, okay, you can't cut the other people off, the control group off. You don't flip a switch and they just stop thinking. And even that, I think, might even be considered a treatment. So it's not possible to evaluate music alone. You're always valuing it or looking at its effects relative to something else, some other way to spend your time, because you can't do nothing. Even when you're doing nothing, you're doing something. Some people call that meditation. Right? So, and also the curriculum, if we think about it, we can't slide music into a school day without something giving, unless we extend the school day. And then if we extend the school day, then we have to ask ourselves, what do we do in that extended school day? Okay, so you're always comparing it to something else. Okay, a curriculum is a group of things, group of classes that are assigned time. So the issue really is I'm going to jump through all this because I don't think it's all that interesting. I can briefly tell you. What it means. Really what we're looking at is, say, a curriculum choice. We saw a STEAM graph earlier that was kind of like this, where you have a class set 1, A, B, C, D, or class set 2, A, B, C, E, and you have to choose one or the other, right? Which means you're going to have to give up D to get E. Or, you know, it might be a little bit of, if you know, want to complicate the model, but I'm an economist and I'm going to simplify. Okay, because there is this time constraint and there's no sugar pill. Okay, each item has its own intrinsic value. Okay, A has value, B has value, C has value. We can try to measure these things. Each item has an instrumental value. Music's probably the largest of the group, I think. But if you look at this problem, some of you, do we have any finance people here, economics people here, and what does this start to look like? I'm trying to select a group of things to occupy my space, what I'm doing. Each has an individual return, and some may have returns that are correlated with others. It's a portfolio problem, isn't it? It's a portfolio. It's just like choosing a portfolio of investments. Okay? I can increase my return, my expected return in a portfolio of investments by diversification, by choosing things that have negative correlations and positive correlations, okay? And what we're talking about, interestingly, with the instrumental value. Instrumental value, what that says, and that's music for math's sake, is to say that music education is positively correlated with the value of mathematics education. Okay, so it's like a hedge or an accelerator element of a portfolio. So the question is, which portfolio creates the highest return? And you think, well, gosh, it's real interesting, Jordan. But what it tells you is it's a guide to say, what do we need to talk about when we talk about value? What is it that we need to study when we talk about this problem? One is net. You have to net the benefit. I mean, it's a net return. Both intrinsic and instrumental value are relevant. And funny enough, there's a huge fight amongst music educators about that. Some people say we shouldn't talk about the instrumental value of music. It's music for music's sake alone. But really, there's two forms of value, and they both matter. And in fact, the fact that they both matter, the fact that there's intrinsic value, leads you into this portfolio mentality. The other thing is that what we're trying to do is figure out the right mix or the optimal mix of what's in the class, okay? It's not that we want more music, we want more music. Because if you want more music, you're going to have to give something up. It's what is the right mix, the optimal mix? And Nina kind of hit on that today. It's this multi-year, you know, heavy-duty study is where these benefits begin to arise. I mean, that's a really important data point if you're talking about how to design a curriculum. You can't design a curriculum for 40 minutes one day a week. That's not going to have the effect that you want it to have. It's got to be sustained and serious. It's got to be a serious effort. Okay, that's the kind of the models that the overall model of how you think about the problem, and then you fit the data points into the model, and it makes that information useful. Advocacy, I think, is important. Look at these statistics. NAM put this survey together. They've done a couple, and they've got a new one coming out. 97% of people agree that music helps a child develop creativity, teamwork skills, make friends. I mean, look at these numbers. This is everybody. This is everybody. Okay. 92% agree. Everybody agrees that music ought to be a regular curriculum. 80% of people agree it ought to be mandatory. Okay. We've already convinced everybody, right? I mean, that's what this tells you? What's going on? Why is it the music budgets are getting cut? Music programs are going away. 80% of people says it ought to be mandatory, yet it goes away. I think one reason, when I look at it, is, let me go back. What gets measured gets managed. What gets measured gets done. Right? You probably see this at work. If it's not measured, who cares? Okay. No Child Left Behind and Common Core don't test music. They test math. They test English. What's everybody focused on? Math and English. Why? You've heard the word accountability in education policy? What is accountability? Screw music. I don't get tested on that. My job doesn't depend on that. I don't get rated as a horrible school because of music. I get rated as a horrible school if my math test scores aren't what they ought to be, or my English test scores aren't what they ought to be. Okay? That's a huge problem. I think the number one, first step to getting music back in the curriculum is to have a test in music of some sort. I can't tell you what that would look like. But that's, you're not, these people aren't going to, administrators, principals are not going to take it seriously enough until they're held accountable for it. Pretty simple point. Research, standardized tests and No Child Left Behind were thought to be the most negative impact programs. That's from a sample of 540 principals. The only thing that counts anymore is what's tested. Okay? Across the nation, the testing obsession has nudged aside visual arts, music, and that old standby penmanship. And I left that last one in. I took a lot of stuff out because, believe me, I got a 10-year-old and they don't teach penmanship anymore. I mean, I had better handwriting when I was 3, I think, and nobody cares. Because you don't get tested. You take a test on a computer. You don't even have to, I don't even think you could color in one of those circles like we had to do when we were little. You know, it'd be all over the place. Okay, I'll finish up here. The music teachers, and I think this goes back to the grassroots effort. If you ask music teachers what's the big deal, often they say it's the micro stuff. It's the principal, it's the parents, it's the community. If you ask the principals, they'll blame it on the test, but they'll also blame it on community. Community matters, parents matter, students matter, okay? And a detailed study in Michigan looked, and it was community, it was parents. So that's the kind of people that you have to activate to get this to move. So you gotta get it tested and then activate the parents, who already agree with you, by the way. 80% of them say it should be mandatory, 92% say it should be there. But still, I think, in the end, overall, music is the language of God, and its intrinsic value should never be set aside for what it does for mathematics, should never be set aside for what it does for English or spatial reasoning, okay? It is what it is. It's the language of God, and that's enough value for me. If these kids up here playing today don't score any better on their ACT test for doing it, we're still good, right? We're still good. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Our next speaker is actually in the trenches, being a musician, teaching other people how to play music, and again, walking the talk. I'd like to introduce Carl Mouton.
I believe,
yeah,
musician, all right. I believe I'm supposed to, yeah, that's the first thing you learn. I'm supposed to tie the academic value, hello, to, I'm from here, so a lot of you I know, academic aspects of music and how it can help the academics. And a lot of people, principals and teachers and people that have a whole other way of, education is always reinvented. I think the big thing now is called tests, right? And they're saying, you know what? We need to learn how to teach kids using this thing called project-based learning. Has anybody ever heard of project-based learning? And I said, oh, really? Project-based learning. I say, how do I do that in music? Oh, let's see. Maybe I'll get my kids up at 6:30 in the morning. We'll get on a marching field, and then I'll assign my students as section leaders. So I just sit there and watch them. I say, this is what they need to learn. And they get together and they learn how to make a circle, and they learn how to march in step, and they're teaching themselves, because level four is distinguished, where you teach yourself. So if you see my rehearsals, you see kids teaching kids, because you show them the way. And so, well, you're gonna have to incorporate all of the core stuff in your band teaching. Oh, really? Okay, let's see. So my band class has to be a language class. Okay, so let's have a rehearsal where the only thing I say is Italian. Presto, allegando, poco a poco accelerando. And then they interpret that as being loud, soft, crescendo, decrescendo. All right, so I got that covered. We're English class now, okay? And they say, well, you know, you have to teach geography. You have to teach this stuff. Oh, okay, well, let's pull out African Patapan from French Guiana and teach them how to do that. Boom, 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 boom. And let's teach our sixth graders, okay? Let's do that. Or let's get out on the marching field and do an adaptation, and this does exist, of March Through the Scaffold by Berlioz, or Can't Buy Me Love. It doesn't matter. Let's teach them something. All right, so, and then they say, okay, and then we want to see the values of it. Well, I can tell them, your valedictorian or salutatorian has been a band student for the past 10 years. So yeah, it does help. I have kids that's in the Wind Symphony, that's the top band in the Allstate. You know, this kid is making a decision between going to Berkeley or going to Harvard or going to West Point. And I'm telling you, he can sit here and play chess against three of you all at the same time. He recites pi for fun. He does. No, he'll do it. I have another young lady who is, two parents live in different parts. She's African American, a low income. She's already been accepted to Yale, and Harvard wants her bad. I mean, already been accepted. She's a junior. She's decided it's a full ride. She's Mensa. You know, I teach people how to play music, but some of them I don't. And I say, here's the horn. Here's the, some, you know, software. Go in the practice room. And by the end of the week, you know, it's like, how do you do that? It really begs to your question, is it smart from the beginning or what? But let me start. So I'm going to want to get the academic things out of the way first. I want to tell you why I do what I do. My mother was a teacher. My grandmother's a teacher. But the number one reason that I'm a teacher is because I believe in education. I've always believed that it was the way. That's the way to get there. And the way I teach music is to get people to listen. That's how you teach a kid to do anything. If I had any advice to give a math instructor or any of the people that's in the core, is that you have to get them to listen to you. You have to be interesting enough, you know, and then give them musical examples. If I grew up in China, I'm an African American, if I grew up in China, had Chinese parents, I would sound Chinese. I say, so they are equipped to listen. Your children sound like you because you raised them. So they're ready for that type of learning. And oh, by the way, what I teach is sound, right? So it's a no-brainer. You teach them to believe in it and love it. Everything I've ever done, any car I bought, house, mortgage, putting my kids to college, I did because either I was playing or teaching music. That's it. Everything about my whole life. I was in Northeast Arkansas early this morning. My classmate passed away, God bless his heart. And, you know, we're sad about it. And I walk in and the band is just slamming. And there he is, and everybody's smiling and clapping and on their feet because of the music. It was so awe-inspiring. And then when people got up, they celebrated his life. You know, I've been to weddings. I played weddings. And it's very important. That one song for the dance, you know, that brought, you cannot get that wrong. You can't. You cannot get that first dance wrong. I played graduations, you know, with my high school band, and they're usually around Memorial Day. Do you really think that you can mess up the Star Spangled Banner when you play that? You're talking about principals and what they care about, and as far as music and stuff. Well, you know, you don't test it. Yes, you do test it. Yeah, you test it. If you go out there and you mess that one up, and all the parents scream and complain and fire the band director, yeah, you can't mess that one up. You learn that really quick, and that's what I tell anybody that's going to be in music education. But I use sayings, and I use metaphors. I love metaphors. They make so much sense because you have to put it in perspective for a kid. You know, I say, look, all of us right now visualize a stop sign. You see it, don't you? Red, white, all like that. I say, that's how you read notes. You look at it and you visualize it, and there it is. I say, you can see that any day of the week. Visualize the letter H. It's right there, isn't it? Why? Because you look at letters all day, right? If I picked up a piece of paper, well, the moral imperative of music education, NAM Foundation, Clinton School of Public Service, I'm not having a problem saying any of those things. Why? Because I look at it. I look at letters all the day, and letters become words, and words become sentences, and eventually becomes a novel, doesn't it? When I go to my reunions, they hand me the music, and I say, you know, I'm talking about band at football games, and it's like, I don't need that. I marched in this band 30 years ago, and I spent so much time playing the music, just call the tune, and I'm there. A lot of keyboard players say, okay, well, let's go to a gig, let's sit in. What are you going to do? Embraceable you, E flat. Girl from Ipanema, F. You just know these things. Why? Because it's that intrinsic value. Chance favors the prepared mind. Who said that? Anybody know that quote, chance favors the prepared mind? Louis Pasteur. Louis Pasteur said, I need this water. Where's the water? When I got up to speak, what was the first thing I did? No, I grabbed, the mic was already in my hand. What was the first thing I did? I'm gonna make it easy. And some of y'all got up, you know, because you know, it's a long thing, you take a break. The first thing you do is look at the direction you're gonna move your feet so you don't fall. Right? I looked, got up, coast is clear, his feet's not in the way, and then I move. Always look when you're reading music or teaching music. You look at it first. I tell my kids, I use metaphors. I say, listen, when you're reading music, you know, you're that scanner at the grocery store. You scan that note, it's, you know, that scanner looks at it, it's a can of peas to it, and it comes up, can of peas, $3, whatever. I say, that's everything. Scan everything about your life. Musicians, Todd, you can attest to this, you have to be able to read a room, okay? You have to be able to read a room, and you have to be able to look and get a sense of what's going on. So one of my other sayings is, develop a sense of awareness. I say it to every kid I have. They got a t-shirt with the back of it. Develop a sense of awareness. I play in a band on Tuesday nights, jam band, and I never, ever, ever have a set list. Because I look at people, and you know, and I see a couple who's been together for 40 years, and you know, they're gonna hear all the things you are, you know. Or I'll be seeing you from that era. Or if some rockers come in, you know, they're gonna hear Beatles, or if it's funk, you know, they're gonna hear some Isley Brothers. You have to read the room. I read the room last night, and what I saw was people enwrapped with what they were hearing. You were children. He had you in the palm of his hands because he knows you and he reaches you, doesn't he? Down here. And that never changes. And you have to do that for a child. I tell him, I say, okay, here we go. You got to listen to me. If you listen to me, I'll show you how to do things. It's all, and they're already playing. I say, no, wait for me. Wait for me. No, they're already playing. Okay. And so I'm going to do to you what I tell them. I say, okay, now, quiet like this. I want everybody in the room within 10 seconds to clap at the same time. There was somebody that started it, right? Now clap. Ready? One, two, ready, go. All right, some of you still wait for the downbeat. This is called the ictus. Greek, ictus. One, two, ready, and. All right, do it again. Now follow me. No! But you see, it's fun, isn't it? And doing that, that's the way a class should be. And then you keep them. I start my kids sixth grade, and I see them move off of 12th grade. So I'm with them. How many teachers do you have for 7 years? You ever had a teacher? Do you have your English teacher for 7 years? No, you have your band teacher for 7 years. 7 years you have him. And you influence and play. I have a first division sweepstakes band. My school is 4 years 4 years old. I have all state kids. I have kids that are studying in music. I have former students that compose for a living. There's a guy that lives out in California. I mean, when he wants to really write, he goes in the Muir Woods and gets his inspiration. but he came from my program. It's just unbelievable. You know, I have people playing in Branson. I have kids playing in New Orleans, and I have kids come and play with me, current students. They come and play with me on Tuesday nights at the jam session that I have. It's in their life. I say, buy the instrument or we'll get it for you. Take that instrument to school, keep it for the rest of your life. The instrument that I bought, that went to school with, took me to the Orange Bowl, took me to the Sugar Bowl, and after I got out of school, I made a living playing it. I'll buy a keyboard for $2,500. I'll keep it for 8 to 10 years and make how much money off of it? The investment is there. So you think about that when you're purchasing instruments for kids in these low-income places, because it can really take them far. Discipline before music. Discipline before the music. You had the discipline for the music. And see where you are now. So you're teaching discipline. That's a big word I learned. Concomitant values. That's what it can teach you. Okay? Research. And these are the things that I've heard. So I need somebody from the audience. Let's see. Somebody who got some nice long legs. Come here, sweetie. Now, I'm going to show you what I want you to do. Okay? This is all I want you to do. Wherever you want to go, just walk. But don't just walk straight. Just walk, okay? All right, whoa, wait on me. All right, now stand away. Turn around. Ready? Go. Go. Thank you very much. What we're simulating is marching, right? But I'm marching and I'm staying in step with somebody, I'm keeping equal distance, I'm not letting her get too far away, I'm not running up on her, and I'm playing music, and I'm in tune with her, and I'm playing at volume level, high, soft, loud, sometimes we stop, and then there's a go. They say there's nothing that you can do in education that accomplishes everything in your brain when you're marching on the marching field. It's every part of everything that you use. It's physical, isn't it? Some of these shows are 10, 15 minutes long. It's musical, you know? So it's the end all be all, as far as I'm concerned. It is everything. And is it valuable? Oh yeah, it is. How many people play an instrument? How many people used to be in choir? How many people used to be in band? Yeah. And you have repertoire, right? I talk to kids, I say, well, I don't know this song. By the time we teach it to them, oh, I'm in love with it. I say, you know what? There's just good music. There's good music. I've heard Hello, It's Me from way back in the 70s. And you allowed, I guess you allowed the Isley Brothers to cover that, did you? Did you allow them? How many people? It's important to me. Y'all heard the Isley Brothers version. They covered your music. You might want to talk to them. That you know you're free. I mean, that was the verse. And it's like some things are timeless. Now I tell them, okay. Oh, they were in the rap really way back in the day. Oh, can't touch this. No. I said, that was borrowed. I say, let me show you something. Here's Can't Touch This. This is programmed for like, in 6 months, we don't want you listening to that anymore because we got another rap song, and we want you to start buying that. I say, you know what? 750 years from now, I could do this to a crowd. Dun, 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 dun. Man, go.
Thank you very much. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, who is the executive director of NAM Foundation, National Association of Music Merchants. And they are very, very active supporting music education in all its forms. Mary is also a professional, were you a professional flautist?
I was. All right. Hold it against me. Yes, I was.
So she's going to talk to us about a call to action.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Kevin, I have to say, you did call me a flautist, right?
I did.
Just remember, that'll cost you more. It's a flutist. That was a long time ago, but I did have the pleasure of being a professional musician, and to be here is really pretty remarkable, and to have all of you here is really remarkable. My job is to kind of, put an exclamation mark, is what I was told, and to talk about how we take so much of what we've heard and combine it in our hearts and our minds and our being around a belief and how we act on that belief. And that is really what the job of advocacy. So, but first of all, it's kind of my consolidator, and I was a teacher for 16 years, so this will probably start to show too. You know, we have to come to conclusions, right? We have to be able to self-engage and be able to draw our own conclusions. So I just would like to turn to the panel briefly. And first of all, Kevin, thank you for revealing what you revealed to all of us. It's not easy. It's not easy to be transparent. And I think as we be as we grow in wisdom and understanding, we're more willing to be transparent because we know how motivating that is to other people. And this is something, as I say these things, I want you to reflect for yourself, because to be an advocate, you have to be grounded in yourself, in your belief for advocacy. And I think the job of this conference is to motivate this beehive, what did you call it? This shared sensibility that radiates here, right? This mysticism that somehow just gets whipped up into a frenzy. And how you can add this process of being this passionate believer for music education, but then what do you do? And I really would like in this next few minutes to give you some things that you can do. And I think, Kevin, you gave us an excellent example of advocacy. You shared in a transparent way, in a way of conviction, a way of revealing how what it meant to you personally, and that is an act of advocacy. That is probably the most core, influential, and important act of advocacy. And you can do it in front of an audience like this, you can do it, you can write it, you can put it on your Facebook page, and everybody gets to see it. Your story, your belief. Nina, we have been so remarkably grateful to support Nina's work, and I think Nina is represents, and when I took this project to our board of directors and said, this is what we're going to fund now, and they all pretty much go, okay, whatever you say, Mary. Yeah. I'm really lucky with that, you know? And they go, we don't understand any of it, but if you say we should do it, we'll do it. And I think after, we took Nina with us a year ago, and she presented this research, the essence of this research, to two education committees, one in the House and one in the Senate, and she took it to the U.S. Department of Education. So we're taking this information, and we're not spinning it. We're not, you know, we don't put a curve on it. We take the scientist to the policymakers, and they say, no, judge for yourself after you see this. And Nina's work goes out to the peer-reviewed community, and she was published in the Journal of Neuroscience last fall. And with her permission, we worked with her, and it went out like a rocket across the general consumer media, because the media is hungry for this information. And I'd say, again, we have a great example of advocacy. We're not touching the outcomes of this research. This research stands alone and has to stand on its own in the peer-reviewed community. And it, only then is it going to make an impact on the way people vote and the way they think and the way they fund? So again, Nina, we thank you for that, again, making a statement with your research and also as a scientist, willing to be transparent in understanding its impact on policy. And that's very, very important. So we really are, with Nina's work, we're really at a cutting edge moment because it represents such validity and such importance. Margaret, please, this is a chance to thank what these people have said. Margaret, you have been a shining example to all of us of the intersection of music and really high standard music learning and music instruction and music opportunity and what it does not only for a child but for family and community. And you've brought this conversation about public health and wellness of a community into the dialogue of music education. And we can be very wonky about this. We really do only want intrinsic things. My band director friend, band director orchestra? Band. I was a band director too. How did I know he was a band director? You know, we really do, you know, at the basic, we just really want all the right notes at all the right time. And, you know, they got to know the history of everything and they got to mark. Because we know if they get that right, everything else will be right too. This is the conflict. If there is a conflict with music teachers, it's because, like, we know if they do all of that right, everything else will just flow. And Margaret, you've taught us that, but you taught us from another angle. And I think these worlds, again, are coming together. When I talk about advocacy, I'm going to get to my part eventually, but if we talk about advocacy, we really are at a very interesting place because of these forces. You know, the Todd Rundgren effect is really working here. All these forces are really come together in a new kind of way. So we thank you, Margaret, for being a big force. You've received a very impressive award from the president a couple of years ago. You know, this is a really, really visionary person. And thank you so much for this view of value about music education. And I think you've also outlined the work that we have to do. And we have a lot of work to do. And Nina and I were nodding at each other while you were presenting because so much of our work to show the value, maybe someday prove the value, but to show it and to describe it and to describe the accountability that is in music and the testing that goes on in music. And I think that there is really progress in this area in the last 2 years because music teachers haven't been afraid of this. They want this accountability. They want this accountability to show their education systems of how well they do. I just think we need some templates and some way of doing things. And again, I really would hope I can have an ongoing dialogue with you because we're moving in the same direction in the work that we'd like to do at the foundation. So again, please thank him for a very important point of view. And to have a music teacher with us, I mean, I how many kids do you teach?
I'll receive about 350.
About 350 kids. 350 souls. Thank you. Thank you for being a great music teacher. I could tell every word that you said what a great music teacher you are and all the lives that you've affected because this is what it's all about. This is what we're fighting for. This is what we're fighting for, and now we have to remember what we're fighting for because the key words are opportunity. What we're really working for as music education advocates is the opportunity that children need to have when they go to school or the opportunity they need in their communities. And sometimes they're not going to get it in school. And sometimes they have to get it in the community. And sometimes a force in the community can force that action to have more opportunity in school. So the words that we're using now that we never really used for music education, and these are some of the differences, We're actually using the words access and equity. We want children to have access to music education in school and community, and we want it to be equal, an equal opportunity for children everywhere, not because you live in a certain zip code where education funding is high and music education traditions are high, but that we're fighting, and we are fighting for it. Now, there are tools and resources and communities that are at this, and the word is, and it's true, they're being pretty successful. When people go in to actually work for music education, things tend to move because of what you told us in those statistics up there. I mean, I have not walked into a member of Congress in the 10 years that I've been doing it, and not once have someone told me I really don't support music education. I never hear it. I haven't talked to a school board member, and we've been to National School Board Associations, and we talked, there's 8,000 school board members there, and they stand up and they scream at the student performing groups that we put up in the plenary sessions every morning of their conference. And they're mobbing us at our stand because they want these great music education programs. So the desire is there. We have to be better at implementing and developing these programs and developing that desire. And that's where you come in individually as an advocate. You need to do something. You need to do something personally and individually as an advocate to make this happen. And I say, well, I can't run for school board. Well, maybe you could, or you could get someone elected that was pro-music education that would help develop the program. You know, the simplest way to do that is on your Facebook page or in your email address that you quote research about the value of music education. If pretty much everyone in this room took off of the NAM Foundation website a little bit of factoid about music education and started spreading it around and mushing it around out there, you know, you become a mobilizing force. And then we have our Support Music Coalition, where 10,000 individuals, businesses, nonprofit organizations that are convening every month via conference call or webcast to share stories with each other about grassroots advocacy. We're modeling. Not long ago, I was in Nashville, and I met with a woman who is a senior vice president with a Grammy organization. And she said that for about 15 years, every year, they would go to the school board, and they would beg them not to cut the program. That was like a regular cycle. They had to go back every year and beg them not to cut the program. And then one year they decided, why don't we change the way we say this? Why don't we ask them to expand the program? And guess what they did? They expanded the program. So we have to be aggressive and focused. And here's the key. This is what I want you to take away from me. We have to be relentlessly positive about this. And if we ask for it, and we do it for what is right for children, and we implement strategically like we would any other curriculum area, we will get what we want, and people are getting what they want. Now, I have to close by giving you a Support Music Coalition resources at NAM Foundation. We just concluded a week of working with the Senate Health Committee. No Child Left Behind has a chance of being rewritten now. We have a chance. We have a chance. But we're not quite ready for the victory lap, okay? We're not quite ready for the victory lap. NAM has been working on subsequent versions of the reauthorization of No Child Left Behind for the last 7-8 years. Every 2 years a new Congress comes in, we start again. Well, if you go to the NAM.org, we have an ESEA tracker. You can look it up and see where we are. As of Thursday, the Senate Health Committee passed their version of the reauthorization. It takes away federally mandated testing and leaves it to the states. For the first time, music is a standalone core academic subject listed twice in the draft of the bill. So we've you know, it's sort of good news, but it's far from over. We have a long, long journey ahead to get it moving. But if advocates hadn't been there doing that these last 10 years, if advocates hadn't been pushing and meeting and building champions in our House and our Senate, we would have never been able to do that. If we'd given up and said, oh, this is just too hard, or we're never going to get there. You know, it's that act of relentless advocacy and relentlessly committed to doing the right thing for kids that this remarkable synergy and energy that comes out of you and this great organization, it will really be a very, very positive force. And we'd like to stay connected to the Spirit of Harmony, the NAM Foundation. There are things that we can do together. There's things that we can teach each other and networks we can connect. This goal needs to link arms, and there needs to be a lot of diversity of activity going on for it to impact the 12,000 school districts we have in this country. So I thank you for your passion, and I think a lot can happen after this night with the energy in the room. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you. We're going to segue into a slightly different element. We have an award we'd like to give. Is Mark Wooden available? Can you bring up the award for us? Oh, here we are. Great. You can just put that there for me. Thank you. And Todd, I'd like to ask you to come up and give the award. This Todd.
Sure.
Not the other Todd.
Oh, yeah. You pointed at me and I thought, oh, I'm going to get... this magnificent, obviously symbolic award, because we're presenting it to President Bill Clinton, partly because we're exploiting the reflected glory of his name here in Little Rock, and partly because I've always believed that Bill Clinton's appearance on the Late Show, with where he played saxophone, essentially put him over the top at that point. And as I say, it isn't always, you know, necessarily the quality of the playing. It's the fact that you're trying. I have a little anecdote that I want to tell. We got invited, thanks to you, to the final Christmas party at the White House one time. And I was frantic to get a gift for the president. I thought, you know, it's Christmas, we've been invited last Christmas, I have to have at least some sort of token thing. So I went to a whole lot of trouble to find what essentially was a gold-plated saxophone mouthpiece. We were in New York traveling down there and didn't have a lot of time. I didn't have time to get it engraved and didn't have time to put a label on it. Like, from me to you, Mr. President, okay? And having never been to the White House before, I didn't know how these things actually went down, so suddenly realized that it probably wound up in a giant pile of presents somewhere, and I'm hoping that it likely went maybe to a school program or something like that in his name. And the least we can do at this point is acknowledge the fact that, you know, he has been obviously a supporter of music. And again, a great thanks for letting us, you know, use the Clinton name in order to get everybody to Little Rock. We'd like to present this, our first Spirit of Harmony Award. that's called the Sing Ring Award, the Spirit of Harmony, the name. The glass guitar, I get it, yeah. For those of you who don't know where the name came from, it came from a little ditty that was on a Utopia record, the Spirit of Harmony, more probably the Spirit of Harmony. Yeah. So the first Spirit of Harmony Award goes to President Bill Clinton. Thank you.
Thank you. Huh? Thank you, Todd. Thank you all. I know we've got other things to do tonight. Thank you very much. I know Bill would love to see this. This is being taped on the Clinton School website. It will be aired down the road, not too far. Please look for it. I want to thank Nikolai DePippa and to Skip for, you know, you can have a name, but someone's got to say, okay, let's bring it, and you did. Thank you for making this happen tonight. Thank you, guys. I know Bill would have loved to be here again. Our family just got really busy again for a campaign. My cousin Roger could not be here tonight. He's had a dream for a very long time, and the first step of it came through a week ago Friday, a week ago yesterday, that's keeping him in Los Angeles. So you've got leftover Clintons, my brother Roy, my sister Teresa, my son Jack, and my nephew Connor Clinton are here. So we'll take this. And I also want to say, you all have changed lives tonight by making it possible for us to bring some local talent to you. The Mabel Vale Drum and Groove Line, Mabel Vale Elementary School, I hope you got a chance to see them. Those kids have it. They did good. They did good. Also, our Arkansas Symphony Youth Rock Orchestra, Jeff Robson, are you still here, Jeff? Yes, thank you. Thank you. Paul? Thank you very much. We appreciate you being our local representative. And also, welcome to Little Rock. Thank you all for coming to Arkansas. Thank you for this wonderful award. It means a lot, and we will get a picture of Bill with it, and we will get it to you. And we're going to find the saxophone mouthpiece. I have a feeling. I think it might be in a catalog somewhere. Anyway, thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So we've all been talking quite a bit tonight. We'd like to open up the floor to questions, if any of you have them. You can direct your questions to any one of our panelists. There are some microphones around the room. So, Terry, how about you? You can start it off.
I just had a question for Dr. Kraus. I was very interested in any of your research. Did it show any differentiation between people who had musical education, formal musical education, and those who are very musically inclined but don't have the ability to read, you know, the actual printed music?
So this is a question that has no answer at the moment. So what in our work, what we have done up until now is we've been looking at kids who play different instruments, different genres, and have learned different ways. So they have learned, reading music, and they have learned without reading music. And we have studies underway. You know, and this is where we're really just beginning. And the fact that, you know, we have biological ways of looking at the impact, this is, to me, one of the most interesting questions. So thank you for it, and I hope that we will have an answer forthcoming soon.
Mary?
If I could add to that, and Nina, I think you know the work of Dr. Gottfried Schlag.
Yes, yeah.
It answers the brain question too, and I'm not a scientist, so please forgive me and Nina fill in the gaps and whack me on the side of the head when I do it wrong. But he did these wonderful functional MRI studies because he had found that the part of the brain that does all these nerve bundlings with professional musicians. I'm talking like a Juilliard trained, someone who spent, you know, the 10,000 hours by the time they were 10, you know, this, and they have this remarkable, what part of the brain is it?
Well, so a lot of the connective tracts.
Right. I mean, this really extensive bundling that doesn't exist in, like, the guy who, you know, doesn't do that. So then he said that the whole idea was to look at young children, and they did 6 weeks of violin training, beginning violin, you know, twinkle, twinkle, you know, scratching along, and that within 6 weeks, that same neural bundling had occurred in the child's brain. So in other words, it was much more developed, but it was almost identical, the pathway. So when you look about, you know, the biological, now Nina's layer of research is expanding that with you know, the way she's looking at it. And functional MRI, you know, that's very invasive. It's children, you put MRIs, you know, the stuff goes in the vein and all that. So, you know, there's, Nina's technique is eliminated some of that intervention. And again, it's the body of this work that's come forward. We have this body of work that we've just never really had before, and it's expanding. Like, you know, it's like, so we have to take advantage of all of that. I just wanted you to know that. So every time you play the ukulele, guys, what's going on? You know, that nerve bundling, you're gonna be more interesting to your kids as you get over it, because you got all that extra baggage up there, you know? It's good stuff.
Great. Let's have a question on this side of the room. Anyone? Gentleman in the back there.
Thank you. I've got one question for Dr. Martin. I've been doing a lot of research into music therapy after floods and tornadoes, and I wanted to get your thoughts on that. And that might be good for you, sir, too, teaching at Maumelle. Another question I've got for you, Dr. Kraus. I have been doing research on auditory processing disorder because I have a coworker who sits near me that sings off-key and drives me batty at work. What research have you done dealing with auditory processing disorder?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the first part of your question, sir.
Yes, I've been doing research for a writing project about music therapy after floods and tornadoes, and I'd like to get your thoughts dealing with post-traumatic growth in music therapy.
Well, the question is actually close to my heart, because I've done research in post-traumatic stress disorder myself, and we talk about it a lot after disasters, but we deal with children that live in neighborhoods constrained by poverty that are ravaged by substance abuse and violence, and a lot of the families are headed by a single parent. When I was doing this research, it was in the 90s, and it was all about men who had experienced apparently inappropriate emotionality post-Vietnam. But any single parent living in a high-crime neighborhood is experiencing the same kind of 24/7 stress and threats to their loved ones. And you only experience post-traumatic stress disorder post. When things are better, that's when you sort of start falling apart. And our experience is that if you want to do something for parents and for families, you keep the kids safe. And you keep the kids deeply engaged, and you help the kids see a positive future for themselves. And I think that we all know that 100 years from now, we'll still be discovering things that music do. But one thing we know for sure is whenever we have a tragic loss or whenever we have something to celebrate, music is there for us, and it never lets us down. So just as our kids, when they've had a horrible day, come in and they slam the door and take out their instrument and start to play, they make their world right. And we can all come together and make our world right with music, and it never lets us down.
Thank you. Okay, we have time for one more question. I see someone over here.
Hi, thank you. My name is Lona, and I flew in from New York to listen to you, and it was, I'm so glad I did. I need your help. I set up a curriculum. I'm trying to start an El Sistema program in the Hudson Valley. It would be an after school. It would be funded by donations. And I set up a 3-hour-a-day, 4-day-a-week curriculum, a violin, bucket band, ear training, a little keyboard, and choir. I did a business plan. I did a pro forma statement down to the penny for every school, including the taxes that I would pay for my to the teachers. I marshaled information, including from the controller of the state of New York, who finds that one child going through the juvenile system costs $200,000, and one career criminal who goes to jail costs an average of $2 million. My program would have cost $77,000 per school per year. It would have been for starting with kindergartners and first graders. My problem is that the school boards that I presented it to filed the information in their permanent filing system. And a local, I've had support from local government officials, a local county, my local county legislator said, oh, it's really, really nice, but he wasn't interested. And I said, well, why not? And he said, he's only interested in things that are doable. And that's why I really appreciate your comments about assistance. So what I would like to know is, can I be of service to you, your organization in California? And could I be of service to you, other of your groups?
We have groups developing all over the country. And it's a lot easier. We've had 2 presidential awards. We have a body of research that's growing, but now we're beginning to have law enforcement and housing authorities contribute for community safety purposes. So as I'm a doctor of public health, and public health is this wonderful big umbrella that has to do with making healthier communities for all of us. And so what we're being increasingly able to do is to bring in diverse funding streams. It's the old thing, many hands make light the load. But in Hudson Valley, I'm happy to tell you that there are efforts underway to launch a Harmony project, and I would like to connect you with those people because I'm sure they will appreciate your support.
So we've been talking a lot about music today. Would anybody like to actually hear some music? All right, so we're going to take a short break. We're going to get the band up, and we're going to, I think I'm going to change my clothes a little bit. I don't feel that music-y in this outfit.
And grow your hair.
And I got to grow my hair again.
You're going to change into that other guy.
I got to become that other guy. All right, so give us a few minutes. Take a short. We're going to have a short break. We're going to come back with some rock and roll. All right.
Yeah. Thank you. Education gets ya.
Thank you.
time. Maybe losing now, but we can't stop trying. Hold that line, baby, hold that line. Hold that line, baby, hold that line. Get up, boys, and you one more time. Maybe losing now, but we can't stop trying. Hold that line, baby, hold that line.
Ha ha ha!